Some people consider 3 a.m. to be the spirit's time to communicate with us. Others think it's the devil's mark. Some even think that if you wake up at this time, that someone is watching you. But if someone were to be watching you, how would they watch you if there were no windows or doors in the room you were in? There are many superstitions for what 3 a.m. could be, but I'm going to tell you the real meaning of this worldwide time myth. See, while you sleep soundly, you dream, and while you dream, you're completely unaware of your surroundings. Unaware of what could be lurking in the closet, under your bed, beside you in the covers, your eyes flutter open and you check the time on either your watch, cell phone, alarm clock, or simply whatever you have lying around that can display time. But knowing the time doesn't really matter, right? So you rub your eyes and blink a few times, adjusting to the darkness of the room. You hear the sounds of floorboards creaking, the sound of pitter-patter along the ground, and you're sure it's just a mouse. I mean, that's what you think to yourself, either a mouse or a really large rat. A very large rat indeed to be making such loud footsteps. You dare not look over the edge of your bed or you're paralyzed with fear. So you're just scaring yourself. Enough with the foolishness, you tell yourself. But is it foolishness, or is there a reason to actually be scared? Are there monsters under the bed, waiting to snatch your feet and pull you under the bed when you get up in the middle of the night to use the restroom to get a drink of water? Now, you don't believe in monsters. Those were stories that your mom or dad told you years ago as a kid, right? The Boogeyman, Sandman, and other monster stories were just stories to give you a spook, right? Yeah, right. Monsters aren't real, you think and chuckle at your childish fears, but wait, what was that? The pitter of feet seem to be getting closer. You squeeze your eyes tightly shut as long as you hear the loud, loud, long screech of your door creaking open ever so slowly. Now, is that a giggle you heard? Of course not. Mice don't giggle, neither do rats. You're being completely fucking delusional. You open your eyes slowly and stare right at your ceiling. And then you see the movement under your covers, the covers that you stay under to provide you warmth and comfort, and it's moving towards you slowly, in this crooked fashion. It looks as if it's limping under the blankets, and you're frozen in terror, afraid to move, or else you might give away your location. You feel something tugging at the loose clothes that you wear. Oh, Jesus Christ, what is that? You yank away the covers and throw them to the ground and gasp at what you see. The creature is lopsided, grotesque in a way that makes your stomach turn in knots. It wears torn fabric that looks like hundreds of years old. It tilts its head to the right and gives you this crooked smile, its dark eyes without pupils staring right at you, unblinking. So you begin to slowly push yourself up into a sitting position, backing away from this creature. That doesn't seem to bother it, though. It slowly just limps closer and closer towards you until it reaches your leg. It pulls itself onto you and begins to crawl slowly, very, very slowly. It bears that crooked, toothy grin. So its gray skin hangs from its bony body. It smells absolutely horrid. It's a smell that you have not ever had to come to face. But you know the smell. See, even without having smelled it before, it's the smell of rot. And not like any rot, the stingy scent of rot, flesh, and blood. So what are you going to do? You think and lick your lips, eyes wide, not removing them from that creature. See, it's still inching its way up your body, coming closer and closer to your face. With each limping step, you take in a deep breath through your nose and then release a scream so loud, you think that you popped your own eardrums. The creature suddenly jerks its head towards the door and lets out this murderous cry. It limps off the edge of the bed and jumps, landing to the floor, rushes out the door and disappears into the dark of the hallway. So you see, 3 a.m. in the morning is when the little things come out to play. When the little things decide it's your lucky day, when the little things show themselves. But don't let this deceive you. See, the first time you see them is almost certainly the last. I mean, you're lucky if you can get away safely. Now, I can't tell you how to deal with these things, because they're everywhere. See, in every home, every hole, nook, and cranny your house has, how many you have in your home isn't a question answered easily. All I can tell you is that there are many. They study you, and they plan your demise. No wonder they reek of death. So this is a little bit of a departure from the kind of stuff that we usually do. I know we cover some gaming stuff, and we cover stuff that's a little more grounded in reality. And it's been a while since I've covered something that's related to, like, actual, like, spooky, real-life sort of things, like real-life, I guess you could say humanoid-esque creatures, where the last thing we really covered was, like, the Rake and things like that, which are these really famous creepypastas where they have these actual, like, beings that are so uniformly known. So over here, there's no actual such clear-cut being, but it in fact focuses on 3 a.m. in the morning. Now, the reason I'm covering the story is actually because I am in fact waking up at 3 a.m. in the morning quite often now at this point. My sleep schedule is kind of off, so I guess to commemorate that, I'm going to cover this spooky, spooky story. As far as the story goes, it's actually rather interesting. I'm not really a huge fan of these stories. I honestly thought it would be a little different at first, but because I don't like stories where they cover a lot of these kind of spooky events, because it doesn't really scare or faze me at all, and it's like, it's one of those things that oftentimes comes off as very, very cringy to me. But here it actually stayed forward through, and I was actually like, if a story can keep me involved enough where I will want to get to the ending, I will do it. There's a lot of times where I cover stories like this before I record them, and I just couldn't finish like half of them because they're just so pointless, and I just stray away. And I think that's most of the creepypasta fandom in general nowadays, right? It's like a lot of these can be kind of cringy, but some of them are just fun to read here and there, and that's sort of what the series is, right? You just sort of spend maybe 10, 15 minutes just reading one and walk about the rest of your day, maybe hopefully getting spooked at like 2 in the morning, right? Which is coincidentally the best time to record one of these. But for those of you who don't know, there's a practice known as demonology. Like, people actually will study the art of, like, understanding demons and paranormal activities. And so for a lot of, like, paranormal investigators and a lot of, like, paranormal teams, 3 a.m. is considered to be the witching hour, right? This is the hour that's supposedly where Jesus Christ died on the cross. And, you know, whatever you believe out of that is whatever you believe. But this is where this is where it originates from. And coincidentally, 3 p.m., you know, the opposite would be referred to as the miracle hour, right? And it would be the inverse of whatever this is. So how this basically works is that at 3 a.m., which, you know, it's, again, it's the witching hour. This is where, like, demonic possessions, witches, like, the occult is at its peak, right? This is where evil takes. This is where, like, generally black magic is a thing that completely takes over. And whether you believe that or not, that's not really the question being thrown around here. It's just that's basically what the 3 a.m. myth tends to be. And that's where a lot of people get the stuff out of. That's why, like, a lot of people consider, like, 3 o'clock in the morning is typically bad luck. And, you know, some people, like, you know, some people that I've talked to that really, really believe this stuff constantly tell me that at, like, 3 in the morning, some weird spooky shit happens at their house. Now, me personally, I don't really notice weird spooky shit at my house, but that's because at 3 in the morning, I'm really just in my office playing video games or doing something else, so I don't really focus on what happens in my house. For all I could fucking know, there's a poltergeist attack going downstairs, and I wouldn't have the fucking clue because I have headphones plugged in. But that's typically what the 3 a.m. witching hour is. So there's nothing really overtly spooky about it, I guess you could say, like, unless you tend to, again, believe in that kind of stuff. But 3 a.m., that's where it comes out from. So how this creepypasta tends to go to is that for the 3 a.m., it decides to give you these weird, like, monsters that it doesn't really describe all the well, but it gives you enough description to basically understand and figure out what's going on, right? Like, obviously there's these weird tiny creatures that are, like, completely decrepit to look at, that, like, stare at you if you're lucky enough to catch them. And, like, this creepypasta says that even if you see them, consider that incredibly lucky, because they could do some horrible, horrible shit to you. And everyone has this kind of stuff in their house. Now, it's kind of an interesting thing in that perspective, because if you take, say, rules out of other religions, right, like out in the world, for example, Muslims believe in jinns, right, which are, like, a different kind of being on this planet, right? Like, basically alongside humans, these entities take place on the same earth, right? And this was one time when I was down in the Middle East, right, specifically Lebanon, and a woman actually, like, showed me how to summon these things when we tried to pick up something that was typically more heavy, right? And it was kind of weird. I think she did some weird kind of, some weird magic trick on me. Like, I still question it to this day, but there was something off about that. And if you kind of take that, because for a lot of Muslims, they believe that seeing these things, right, in their true form would fucking kill you, right? It would deliver you the worst kind of a heart attack. It's almost similar to that in a way. So it takes the aspects from, say, 3 a.m. from, like, you know, many Christian, like, the Christian sect of religions, and, you know, you combine it with a little bit of that, and you sort of have this weird combination where it takes the, I guess you could say, the best of both worlds, or the best of everything in a way, because there's little interesting things sparsed out through, and it gives you something that, you know, of course, we would always like to sit there and think that none of this shit is real, right? And I'm a skeptic myself. I don't believe any of this kind of stuff is typically real. And that's just because if I need something to be real, if I want to believe something is real, I need some sort of evidence to it, right? If you tell me that there's some weird, spooky, some spooky little tiny creatures walking around my bed, I'm not going to be scared until I actually happen to see it. And God forbid I see it, because I'm a little baby and I would shit myself entirely. But just knowing that, like, there are so many groups in the world that end up sharing very similar beliefs, right, that are from different parts of the world, it kind of leads a little bit of credibility, right? Like, say in country A, B, and C, they have the same old folklore story of this kind of shit, right? This kind of stuff. And it's just told differently, right? But it's still the same thing at the core. There's got to be some legitimacy to that, right? Because if everyone's coming up with the same thing, right? Like, if everyone comes up, like, if people say this is what a dinosaur looks like, and country B and C, for example, say that's exactly what a dinosaur looks like, maybe slight variations, there's got to be some legitimacy to that. Now, as far as this creepypasta goes, I think I'm going far off on a tangent on analysis, but that's kind of what the analysis section is. It's just basically taking a little bit of outside media and putting it into this and sort of giving this a little more credibility and sort of giving it a little more oomph than it actually initially had. So as far as this creepypasta is considered, you got some spooky stuff in your house in every nook and cranny. So let me know what you think about it. Let me know what you think. Let me know how you perceive the witching hour to actually be. Do you get up at 3 a.m. often? Because, you know, if you do like me, then let me know what you do in the comment section below. Let me know what you think about the 3 a.m. myth. Is it just a myth, or is there something real behind it? And if there's something real behind it, do you think it's some spooky little entities around your place trying to haunt you? Or is it something far more sinister, or just something that's not there at all? Let me know what you think in the comment section below. I would really like to see the actual, like, you know, input towards this. But this has been another episode of Creepypasta as part of Haunted Gaming. If you like what you saw, please like, comment, and subscribe. Just like if you dislike it. Next time, we'll take a look at a lovely gaming creepypasta, hopefully. This is me, Mudahar, and I am out.